giant voice. The official podcast of the United States Navy's largest overseas installation, Commander Fleet Activities, Yokosuka. All the information you need to succeed as a forward deployed sailor in Japan. Each week, we tackle one topic and speak to experts who can answer some of your most frequently asked questions. This is
the Giant Voice Podcast.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode. This episode is pretty special for us. It's going to be our first guest from sort of outside of the Navy or military in general, and also from outside our local area here at Yokosuka. Just a quick heads up, this episode is pretty funny, and we had a really good time making it. But there's a few adult jokes in there. Based on the advice of sort of our chain of command here at Yokosuka, we bleeped out any swear words, but there's still some, you know, kind of adult jokes and themes, so yeah, just be ready. Our guest this week has a host of credits, including comedian, actress, producer, and screenwriter, as well as six Netflix comedy specials. We welcomed her on base a few weeks ago for a USO show that went really, really well, and I think everybody had a great time at. Joining her on the podcast are comedians Hunter Hill and Laura Peake. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Iliza Shlesinger. Thank you guys so much for joining us. Iliza, I watched you on Last Comic Standing many years ago. We're the same age. So
elder millennials, unite.
Yes, elder millennials. I am 40, and it is scary.
It's nice to see another one of us out in the wild. And standing upright, walking, no issues.
I'm barely walking, barely. I was in the military, so, you know, the knees are not in good condition.
I saw you on the way in. You did a good job. No notes.
Okay, all right. But yeah, so thank you guys so much for being here. Welcome to Japan. I got to ask you first, what do you think of Japan so far? Is this your first time here?
It's not. I've been here several times.
Okay.
It is their first time.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Do you want to maybe ask, do you guys...
First time here in Japan. I mean, first of all, it's the greenest place I've ever seen in my entire life. It's so lush. It's so humid and beautiful.
Yep.
Getting here, I mean, we just got to this base, you know, an hour ago.
Yep.
But spent time at Yokota. The people are amazing. The views are unbelievable. I love it. And we're going to get to go into Tokyo for a little while, too.
Nice.
So, I mean, it's just been an experience. It's been so cool so far.
Thanks,
Hunter,
excellent.
Go. Yeah, we're stoked. I mean, we've been just being shuttled around like crazy from base to base. But every time we're in a bus on the way to the next place, my face is just smushed up against the glass.
Awesome.
I love these weird cages that are on the side of the road that just make you think that there might be a raptor enclosure on the other side of the highway. But it's been beautiful. The people have been amazing. We're going to take the bullet train to Kyoto, I think.
Awesome.
In a few
That's
days.
An experience.
Yeah. Little kid in me is stoked on that one.
Good. Yeah, I came here 10 years ago with the military. I got out. I married a local and I never left.
There you go.
If I could stay, I would.
Yeah, that's how much I love it. So, and you've been here before. Mm-hmm. What's your favorite thing in Japan? What do you think?
I just think it's always a treat as an American to go somewhere that is the opposite of where you're from. You know, even when you go to Europe, there's a lot of Western things.
Right.
And so to get a chance to immerse yourself in someone else's culture and to just go with it and to be in a culture that really appreciates if you try.
Yes.
You know, and it is a, you know, difficult language, but the people are so kind, accommodating, and I love the structure. I love the order. I love that we always talk about like how if a train is not running on time, it means someone killed themselves.
Yes.
I love that. Obviously, I love that. Listen to me. I live in LA, and so nothing's ever on time.
Yes.
But obviously everyone loves the food, and it's always nice to see, you know, it's beyond sushi. There's a whole
there's
world.
So much.
So anytime you get to leave your bubble to really immerse yourself in someone's culture and just get lost. My goal when I travel is to be the only white person. Like you go somewhere, you spend all this time and money, and you go somewhere and you're just surrounded by a family from Chicago just yelling at each other, and you're
Connor.
Like Connor, you don't realize how hard our R's are until you are on a regional flight to Hungary and you're hearing like, Robert, give me your bag, and you're like, shut the so loud. And so, and there's also obviously so much intercultural history between our two countries. Yeah. So getting to see the military aspect, seeing how these two countries have formed like a bond, and seeing the Japanese military in conjunction with ours versus just like a fake military. Sometimes you go to countries and you're like, are these troops
really
cute?
Yeah.
Cute gun.
They're like the JV squad of military.
B team.
No, this base has a tremendous amount of history, right? Like some of the ships that attacked Pearl Harbor were built on this facility. Wow. Like the building you're
in. Well, that's
awful. Yeah.
Cool.
You know, yeah, awesome.
What started it all?
This building's 100 years old. There was submarines built here, in the 1930s and 40s. There's a lot of history on this base. And you're right. Like, I know it's goofy military stuff, but, you know, you go from being enemies to the closest military alliance in the world, maybe ever, between two countries. Mm-hmm.
Well, we took a Huey over downtown Tokyo.
Oh, it's so awesome, right?
It was so awesome. Yeah. And I asked the pilot, I was like, how do the locals feel about looking up and seeing a foreign aircraft constantly flying over? Because as an American, it's something you would never see.
Right.
And he explained that they do a really good job of making sure to not fly at certain times and to always be respectful, which I think America does a better job of than we get publicity for.
That is correct.
And I was like, you know, the alternative is we could not be here and you guys could all be speaking Russian.
Yeah, exactly.
So
right.
take the helicopter.
Yeah. When I was active duty, I also did this, and I worked for American Forces Network, the television station.
Oh, yes.
And I was a broadcast reporter. But one of the things I often did was aerial photography out of Huey's from
cool.
Yokota.
Oh, wow. Very cool.
So I did that quite often.
Then I won't show you my
Tokyo.
Pictures.
Oh, I'd love to see your
like
pictures.
Like dusty pictures of Tokyo Tower.
I would love to see your pictures.
Portrait modes come a long way.
Yeah, exactly.
Just talk about something not doing justice.
It's all just selfies of you.
that's what the people want. Blurry selfies from 1,000 feet up.
So, well, that's awesome. And you've done other USO tours as well. What are some of the other places you've been?
I've done a few chairman tours during Christmas. So I've gotten to go to, I've been to Afghanistan twice. I've been to Iraq, Diego Garcia, which is a real bragging point. Because, when do you get the chance?
Nobody
No one's
there.
Connecting through there on their way to Burbank.
See one of those big crabs there, man? The coconut crabs?
Did I see a crab?
It's like the size of a garbage can.
I was young when I went, so I might have just been blasted the whole time.
Yeah, possible.
I've been to Guam. I've been to Kyrgyzstan, Poznan, Poland, Germany. I know I'm missing one right now. Qatar. That wasn't for USO. Oh, that was just for the military. So now that I think about it, I've gotten to do a lot.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
It's cool. It's a real privilege and honor to get to perform for you guys.
So that was my next question is like, do you have a family connection or a personal connection with the military? Like,
yeah, that's to me the cool part about me. we were saying this last night, you know, all of us being Americans have, for the most part, grandparents who, of course, fought in World War II, right?
Right.
But aside from that, I don't come from a military family. Background. I don't have friends. I do now, but growing up, it just wasn't in my purview. It just wasn't my world. And when I got asked to do my first USO tour, which I think was 2016, I'm sure they have it on a government record somewhere.
Yeah.
It was just something I was asked to do. And so I just went. No one really knew who I was, but I was blessed with and imbued with this context for what our military actually does day in, day out. And the actual sacrifice, it's very easy to say thank you for your service. But when you see this, like I goosebumps thinking about it. I think I was like 26 at the time. You see these like 18-year-old kids who are in charge of multi-million dollar aircrafts.
Yep.
And sacrificing, in many cases, their lives, but their time with their families, their time away from their pets.
Their youth.
Their youth. I mean, aren't we all?
Yeah.
But just to see that and to really get an understanding for the sacrifice that this takes and the selflessness, because it's not something that I would be able to do.
Right.
Even the most basic job, I think, would be very hard for me. I'm not great at listening.
You might surprise yourself.
I might. I could fill a trash can. I don't know. But just to get to that. And so you get a context for what they're doing over here and missions. You know, depending on the news you watch, it's always so easy to on your own country or to freedom ain't free. But when you really see what goes into this and how important every single job is and how everyone is a cog in this massive machine that really makes the world run as smoothly as possible, it really gives you insight and context for, you know, when people argue online about freedom of speech. It's like because of these kids and these adults, obviously, that are giving their time and their lives to ensure that you can act like a asshole on TikTok.
Yeah.
So it's a respect and an appreciation that I never would have had otherwise.
That's really great. I think another thing that shocks a lot of people is how diverse our military is.
Yep.
Like, you know, maybe some people kind of have a preconceived notion of the type of person who joins the military.
Like a jarhead.
Right.
Right.
And then you get here and you see it and it's like, here's a single mother. Here's yep. every ethnicity you could imagine, every part of the country. Like it. That was a great thing for me. I had lived overseas before joining, right? Mm-hmm. And I joined the military and I'd explored overseas, but I had never explored my own country.
Right.
And being in the military was like, look at the amazing diversity my own country
that
has.
I'm fighting to protect. Exactly. I should go check this out.
Exactly.
But yeah, it's definitely not the stereotypical. I mean, I'm sure those people exist because you need them. But these are educated people. These are people like you and me, all religions, all colors. And all genders and all types of sexuality.
Absolutely.
And so I know
we're
that
we're proud of it.
And that is the way it always should have been. If you want to pick up a gun or enlist and you are trans, you're gay, whatever, that is a sacrifice I could not make. So good on you and God bless America.
And do you know the military's logic is? Come on in. Because the more diverse perspective we have, the more effective of a military we are.
Sure.
Different ways of thinking make us be able to tactically assess things better. I've celebrated Pride underway on a ship with the rainbow flag.
Just you alone in a control room.
Just me.
You're like, yes, queen.
Still a good
Let
time.
Let freedom ring, bitches.
Just on a canoe with
It's me.
No, the whole ship. Like, we literally flying the flag at sea.
Well, it's actually something I notice when I'm over here is the... I mean, look, I'm sure people, there's issues and stuff like that, but... You know, I've had people in the military say it to me, like, when you're in a foxhole, when you're under fire, when you're combat, it does not matter the color of the person
That's
pulling
right.
you out.
Yeah.
And you do see a sort of color blindness to people in the military because they've been through the shit with these people and they do view them like family. And I think that that's incredibly special. Like, you go through that training together and you got to be there for one another. And it really does level the playing field.
That's awesome.
I say that as an observer. I'm incredibly racist.
No, I think it's a fantastic perspective.
Yeah,
I'm really happy to hear it. Hunter, Laura, like, is this your guys' first USO tour?
Yeah, this is both of our first times. I mean, this is such a bucket list opportunity for me. Like, for me as a comedian, as a fan of comedy and a fan of our country, there's just like, I think comedy is beautiful because it's all about like finding light in dark times.
Yeah.
And as a fan of our country and comedy, like, I just started out watching clips of people doing USO tours. Mm-hmm. My grandfather served in the Navy. My wife's grandfather sent me a text message on my way over here that when he was in the Navy, he was a tailor and sewed Bob Hope's uniform for USO tour.
That's cool.
So this is just such a surreal, incredible experience getting to be able to do this and meet everyone and check it off the list.
That's awesome.
Same. It's like touching a very specific part of a patriotic part of my heart. And I had heard mostly about USO tours through Iliza and getting to know Iliza. And from the jump, she was just like, this is an experience you'll never get anywhere else. And so I've been champed at the bit to do it as well. But getting to go to do that first show last night at Yokosuka, it's like the amount of gratitude I had to be able to make people laugh in that environment.
Yeah.
Like, it feels so special. And it's everybody's families. Everybody is just like so psyched to relax for a second and have a good time. It's like, what an unmatched feeling as a comic.
That's great.
Yeah.
People are coming up to us after shows saying thank you. And we're like, are you kidding me? Like,
thank you.
You guys are warming my heart.
People come up and they're like, thank you so much for coming. Like, we took a first class flight here.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
This was not a sacrifice.
We got a free trip to
Japan. I was not booked this week.
Yeah.
But it is our honor to get to support you guys in this way, truly.
Well, we're glad we're down here. We're glad you're down here at the Navy base. I think you might notice a difference between the crowds. Sailors have a reputation for being a little bit more rowdy than maybe the Air Force does.
Well, that's good, because so do I. So strap in and strap on. It's going to be a bumpy ship ride. Choppy waters.
We were talking.
Don't test me.
We were talking at lunch. There was a woman that came up last night, and she was like, that was show is fun. A little dirty every now and then. I was like, yeah, sure. She goes, the Navy's going to love it.
Oh, yeah. So that's the reputation is like this, is Marines are dumb. Obviously, none of this is true, right?
We're like
brothers and sisters who tease each other.
Sure.
Right?
Sure.
Of course.
So the Marines are neat crayons, okay? The Army are a bunch of jerks. right? They take themselves way too seriously.
Cool roast. This yep. is serious ribbing. Yeah. You guys eat crayons. Oh, man, how are they going to recover from that jab?
And the Navy is inappropriate.
Filthy.
That's filthy.
Well, all of these yeah. combined are a regular crowd at the Comedy Store.
Yeah, exactly,
so
yeah.
We're fine.
Yeah. You guys are good.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, these are just people, and these are the same kind of people that would come out to Certainly. See you on the road, and it's important to look at them like that. I've definitely done military shows that were not geared toward comedy. I was telling them, like, when I started these USO shows, like, I was doing crowds that were really more men than women.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And obviously there's more and more women now, but like I did a show at a FOB in Afghanistan on Oof. A deck at noon, like also to the Afghan quote unquote troops. And I was just like, is it cool that I have short sleeves on? Or are you going to lose your mind? And you're just trying to find a commonality, make people laugh. But we had a great show last night and we plan on having a better one tonight.
Yeah. It was so fun.
We do yeah. plan on it.
Yeah. All right, Taylor, you having a flashback?
Yeah. Are you good? Just holding yourself in the corner. No,
he was in the army in Afghanistan.
That's oh, were you there? That was a rough show.
In Iraq. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, we're just happy to be here.
Well, no, that's fantastic. And then after this, you guys are going to Iwakuni?
Iwakuni. It's pronounced Iwakuni.
It is pronounced Iwakuni. Nihongo shabete imasu ka?
Choto.
Skoshi.
Yeah, skoshi. Yeah, we're going to Iwakuni. It's only three bases.
Yeah.
And so, you know, when you sign up for these tours, I've done, like, the couple tours I've done, like, you're on the chairman's schedule, and, you know, he gets up yeah. at 2 a.m. for a workout, and your lobby call is 3 a.m., you better be there. And they just kind of drag you on like a ragdoll, so you kind of put out of your mind that you're jet-lagged and tired, because it is a drop in the bucket compared to, like, what our military goes through.
Yeah.
So, well, yeah, we're tired and, yeah. and sweaty, but we're just along for the ride.
And you sleep when you get home, man.
Sleep when you're, yeah. 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 I have a baby, so maybe not.
Yeah.
Sleep on the plane.
How old's your baby?
She's 18 months old, and she, Hunter's baby's only 2 weeks older.
Yeah. Wow, congratulations.
Yeah, we travel together, man. And we both have little babies.
I have a six-year-old, and so I will tell you, it gets mildly easier. Oh, right. Asleep.
Wildly. He's selling it.
I yeah. sold her down the river. I sleep fine. She's yeah. great.
Go, you she's just sleep.
It's just a joke. I find that when I make that joke, other parents are like, she gets it. No.
Here's
she
a bottle sleeps, of vodka.
She sleeps
kid.
Like a rock. She's fine. She's 8 feet tall and she eats like a grown man. And she sleeps like she's in an alcoholic coma. She's fine. She's huge.
She's 8 feet tall.
She's very strong. She's Do not strong. Take her food away from her.
She's in charge of the house.
Yeah.
This is
yeah.
not the first time I've heard Iliza describe her baby as 8 feet
She's
tall.
Massive.
That makes me laugh.
I worry for the dog's safety. She's been trying to like get
is she
on the dog.
Eat the dog?
She tries to ride the dog. She grabs the dog and we're like, gentle. Anyways, she's great.
Yeah, like yeah. those are all the things you're supposed to want to do with a small dog
yeah.
when you're that kid.
Yeah.
I tried it. Yeah. I tried it.
There's a whole thing in Japanese culture about something is so cute that you want to eat it or destroy it.
I have a whole bit about
like
that.
They have a whole.
What's the word? What's the term here?
Now I can't remember it. It's escaping.
Because in the U.S. it's cute aggression.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is that? And then there's also kimo kawaii here, which means
cannibalism.
Grotesquely cute.
Because kawaii okay. culture is
kawaii is
which
cute.
It's yeah. funny because like so many products are kawaii culture, and I'm like, are grown men buying these
oh,
like rabbit shaped lollipop?
Yeah.
Like it's so. I've never yeah. seen a man in America be like, it's so cute. I gotta yeah. get it.
I'll tell you, there's a different view of kind of masculinity here
yeah.
in Japan that's very very different. And like you will see the most beautiful women. And the men that they
and they
are
turn
with,
out to be dudes.
they're all dudes. but they will be with men who, in the United States, people will go like, "Oh, no way, that dude ever gets
right.
girls, right?" But here, like, that's it's just. A
I think
different
what you're
dude,
talking about is a lack of homophobia.
Exactly, yes.
which
yes.
is a very
yes.
American
meaning,
thing.
Like grooming yourself and
right.
and looking nice and dressing nice.
Yeah, wearing deodorant doesn't make you gay.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, yeah. we're looking forward to the rest of this visit. We're gonna go see the dogs, right?
Yeah.
Oh, you're going
That's
to see the
we're
working
going
dogs.
Next.
Tactical
yeah.
dog
yeah.
training.
Dogs. Yeah.
Are you guys all dog people?
Oh, yeah.
Big dog.
I have requested. They're like, you can't touch them. And I was like, but can I kiss them? It's different. Kissing them on the mouth. Because if you think about it, they probably don't get a lot of foreign kisses. And I think it's time to introduce them to my biome yeah. and my mouth and give them kisses and let them know, you're a sweet girl. You don't have to work right now.
We've been trying to talk her out of this.
Your biome is going to be in their stomach after they bite your face.
And that is true inter-country relations. Do you want our countries to be bound together? It's not going to happen through the military. It's going to happen through French kisses.
We're tired. We haven't been sleeping.
I would be saying this regardless. I couldn't bring my dog. I did request it. You can't bring your dog to an island. That's fine. Plus, she's Chinese. I don't know how they feel about that here. There's a bit of a history there. Chinese rescue dog. But yeah, but we're going to go there now. But this was great.
Yeah. Hey, you guys, really, really thank you so much. You guys made me laugh. And also to all the kind things you said, really, it means a lot to me. And I'm sure it means a lot to everyone who's listening and everyone on the base and in the military in general.
So yeah, you guys matter. What you do matters.
Thank you so much for being here, you
thank
guys.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
This was awesome.
All right.
And thank you for the snacks.
Much. Of course.
Yeah. Thanks for having us.
All right. Thank you, guys. Take care.
The Giant Voice Podcast is a production of Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka Public Affairs Office. The views expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the policy of the Department of the Navy or Department of Defense. Thanks for listening.